Hey guys, Joe Cannon here, and in today's video, I want to talk, again, this is my second video, on a topic of rhabdomyolysis. Those of you who know me know that this is actually a topic I'm quite passionate about, and one of the reasons is most people have never heard of rhabdo or rhabdomyolysis, which is muscle fiber death. And this video today is sparked out of something I've noticed in a while, people posting on social media with hashtag rhabdo to show people how intense their workout was. And that says to me that I don't think people are taking this medical disorder serious. And I want you to know that it should be taken serious, and people, unfortunately, have died from rhabdomyolysis. So that's one of the things I want to share with you in this quick video. I also want to delve into a few other things as well, which I hope will help you. Real quick about me, I don't talk about myself too much, but I know there's people talking about rhabdo on the internet, and I want you to know that I'm probably one of the people in America, if not the world, who keeps up to date on this the most. I have spent over 10 years investigating this topic. I'm also the author of the first book ever written on rhabdomyolysis as well. My master's is in exercise science, undergrad biochemistry, and I have been quoted and talked to the New York Times, Daily Beast, and even NASA on this topic as well. So I have a lot to say, and I'm going to talk a lot in the next few minutes to you about this topic, and hopefully you'll learn some things that you hadn't heard of before. So real quick, what am I going to talk about in this quick video? Well, I'm going to give you a quick synopsis of what rhabdomyolysis is. I'm going to show you some proof that people actually have died from this disorder. I'm going to give you some ideas on what can increase your risk of this. And I'm going to talk about things as well most people are not talking about. I'll give you my thoughts on what I feel are the most important things to be on the lookout for. I also want to bust some myths out there. There are myths circulating about rhabdomyolysis, and some of them are told by the so-called experts who discuss this topic. And then also give you the odds of actually dying, which I'll let the cat out of the bag right now. I think the odds of death of rhabdo are low, but it's still, death is pretty serious, so we want to take this pretty seriously. So rhabdomyolysis, basically the word means muscle fiber death, skeletal muscle fiber death. That's what the word means. And again, what happens when you exercise too intensely for your own good, your muscle fibers die and their cellular contents leaks into your bloodstream, and it can cause some pretty scary side effects. And I've listed a few here. Your heart could actually start changing the way it beats, and you can sometimes actually feel that. But in a worst case scenario, you can actually have a heart attack from rhabdo. There actually was a heart attack in 2018 of somebody running a half marathon. And I've actually talked to other people who've given me reports of heart attacks, which usually don't get on the news. Another side effect of this condition is kidney failure, and that's actually is often said to be a rare side effect of rhabdo. And I keep wondering, if it's a rare side effect, how come everybody I talk to, which is a lot, who've gotten this condition, tell me they've went into kidney failure? So what are the odds of kidney failure? Is it rare? It probably is, but again, I can't give you any odds. But many of the people who I've spoken to have had kidney problems. So how rare is it? Hard to say. One side effect that nobody likes to talk about, or rather a few people do, is that it is possible to go into liver failure with rhabdo. So people tend to focus a lot on the kidney problems, but there are individuals whose liver will start to be affected by this condition as well. And so doctors sometimes will measure liver function. And another thing that most people actually who have ever had rhabdo have run into is the worst muscle pain they've ever had in their life. I always think about a woman who's had rhabdo before, and she told me it was more pain than giving birth. And so for us men out there, it's hard to imagine, but this is a horrific pain. And one of the telltale signs of rhabdo, if you look in my previous video, is it rhabdo or is it delayed muscle soreness? One of my litmus tests is when it's rhabdo pain, your muscles hurt even though you're not moving. Delayed muscle soreness, like we've all had probably before if we work out a little bit too much, that pain doesn't hurt until we move. Rhabdo hurts when we're not moving. Okay. There is also a fatigue that can last when people have rhabdo for many months, even after they get out of the hospital. And the range of fatigue is various for different people. Some people, it's a profound fatigue. They have trouble walking up a flight of steps. And other people, they just feel tired all the time. I can't give you a time course on how long it takes for this to dissipate. I just know that a lot of people who get this disorder do report fatigue. And then rounding up these side effects is the last one, which I don't believe I hear anybody talking about, and that's a post-traumatic stress disorder-like syndrome. Many people who get rhabdo, they all say the same thing to me. Number one is, no one ever told me this could happen. I've never heard of this before. And number two, it was the worst pain I've ever had. I was in the hospital. I incurred medical bills from this. And because of all this, I'm terrified to work out again. So I call that a post-traumatic stress disorder-like syndrome. So it is possible that, you know, you may be afraid to work out again. So if that is you, I just want to address this. What you're experiencing is something that I've been told by many other people over the years. So let's just cover a few cases of people who have passed away from rhabdomyolysis. CBS News reported in 2012 that there were at least 21 college football players who had died from rhabdo and rhabdomyolysis side effects between the years 2000 and 2011. These were obviously young, fit individuals, and unfortunately, they died. Many of them died during training practice as well. So that's something that I want to bring up in the next slide. It's the start of the season when some of these individuals started to get the disorder. There was a police officer in 2018 who died during a police training exercise, which that made the news, which you may have seen on TV. And then there was a triathlete in 2015 who died in Colorado doing an Ironman triathlon. These are just three cases that I just picked out for you. They are not the only cases. I have uncovered other cases over the years, and actually have met people who've told me of additional cases which have never made it on the news. So people who put hashtag rhabdo next to their workout, your workout was not that bad, because you didn't die. So I really wish people would stop using that hashtag on social media, because it really mitigates this very serious medical condition. What increases the risk of this disorder? Well, there are several things. Number one on the list, which I believe is the most important, is when you do things you're not used to doing. Any kind of new or unusual exercise class or exercise program or activity. I just don't want to put the onus on exercise here. You might, for instance, get rhabdo after doing an awful lot of gardening, for instance, or maybe you're painting a house or painting a room. It's that repetitive nature of the movement over and over and over again, which seems to make rhabdo more likely. So new and unusual exercise and activities and repetitive motions over and over and over again, doing the same thing. That seems to set people up for this disorder. Another thing that can increase someone's risk of getting this disorder is when you, say, work out for a long period of time, and then maybe you take 3 or 4 or 5 months off, and then you go back into the gym 4 or 5 or 6 months later, you go back into the gym with the very same intensity you did, say, 5 months before. Well, that's going to put you in the hospital in some cases with rhabdo. And there are incidents of people who return to exercise, they don't build up to their former fitness level, and then they wind up in the hospital with rhabdo. So if you're going to take a hiatus from exercise, start back slowly. Don't just jump right back in where you were 6 months before. Pushing beyond your mental breaking point is something that I have seen in individuals who do group exercise classes. They either A, want to keep up with the group, or they're trying to keep up with the person instructing the class. The class is usually dark, so they dim their lights in many classes so the instructor can't see if you're running out of steam. And many people are afraid to, say, walk out of the room when they've had enough. But pushing beyond your mental breaking point is definitely something that could bring this about. And actually, not only with exercise classes, but also working one-on-one with a personal trainer. As you may know, I teach personal training, and I lecture to thousands of people every year. And I can tell you, most personal trainers in the world have never heard of rhabdomyolysis. And I could talk for hours on why that is, but I'm just going to leave it at that. They don't know. So do not push beyond your mental breaking point. When you think you've had enough, speak up, walk out of the class, tell the trainer, I've had enough. And don't be afraid to say no. Lack of fluids as well as exercising in hot temperatures can increase your risk of this disorder as well. And again, fluids help you dissipate heat. Exercising in the heat can make rhabdo more likely to occur. So both of these, I usually say, go hand in hand together. But number four, the lack of fluids actually leads into a myth that I want to address in a minute as well. But do I want you to stay hydrated? Absolutely, I do. Do I want you to try to avoid new and unusual exercise activities in hot temperatures? Yeah, I'd like you to build up to that before you start exercising in really hot temperatures as well. There are some genetic traits that increase your risk as well. You may have heard of the sickle cell anemia trait, and this is a genetic condition where someone has one gene for sickle cell anemia, and that in that case, they don't have the disease, but this trait can increase the risk of rhabdo. And some colleges will actually do genetic testing on their athletes for the sickle cell anemia trait. And again, there may be other, there are other traits as well, but that's one that usually people may have heard of. And then rounding out the risk factors, there are some medications that can increase your risk. Most notably is one that you may have seen on television, and that is cholesterol-lowering medications. If you look at the TV commercials, you'll hear them mentioning things like if you have any muscle pain or weakness or dark-colored urine, talk to your doctor. That's a reference to rhabdomyolysis. They don't use the word rhabdomyolysis on TV because they don't want to scare anybody. The word itself sounds pretty scary, but that is the rare side effect that people report when they take this medication. So if you're taking that medication, you're exercising intensely, theoretically you are at an increased risk of this disorder. And the same goes with some supplements. One that comes to mind immediately would be a cholesterol-lowering dietary supplement called red yeast rice. Red yeast rice can lower cholesterol, and why? It actually contains a natural occurring statin medication. So there are some reports, not a lot, of some of people getting rhabdo on that dietary supplement. So in theory, taking that supplement or some medications could increase the risk of this disorder. Okay, so let's now jump into some myths. There's three big myths out there when it comes to rhabdo that I want to address that I think people need to be aware of. And that is, if your urine is not dark colored, you're okay, and you don't have rhabdo. And I'm bringing this up because everybody who talks about rhabdo now puts the emphasis on dark-colored urine, and that's because it is a side effect of rhabdo. If your pee looks like, say, iced tea or Dr. Pepper, Coca-Cola, Pepsi color, that dark brown-colored urine, that's a sign of rhabdo. Unfortunately, they hammer this so much that people think if their urine does not look like that, that they're okay. And I'm here to tell you that's not necessarily true. There are many people out there who get rhabdomyolysis who have perfectly quote-unquote normal-looking pee. And so don't just look at the absence of urine color change that means you're okay. The only way to really know for sure is to go to the hospital and get a blood test and a urine test, and they'll tell you within minutes if you have rhabdo or not. Just don't look at the pee. Your pee does not have to be dark colored to have rhabdo. There is another myth that I like to try to address when I can, and that is the water and rhabdo myth. And this basically goes like this. If you think you have rhabdo, drink a lot of water and you'll be okay. No, I'm here to tell you that's not true. People who say drink a lot of water are thinking really the bottom left-hand corner of the big picture. They're looking at kidney function. They're saying, if you drink a lot of water, this will help reduce your risk of kidney failure. Okay, that's great. But remember, rhabdo does more than just affect the kidneys. Water does not stop muscle fiber death, which is what this condition is. Remember, for instance, your liver could be affected by rhabdo, and water is not going to help your liver get better. So again, my fear, my bringing this up because my fear is that people who think they may have rhabdo and they hear water, 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 sit home by themselves and drink like a fish, drink all this water. My fear is that they don't get medical attention when they need it. And theoretically, there is a condition of drinking too much water, and it's actually called hyponatremia, and that can be almost as deadly as rhabdo. There are people, you can wind up in a hospital from drinking too much water. Obviously, you have to drink an ocean of water to get this condition, but again, when you only hear water, 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 my fear is that person staying at home and they just bite the bullet and drink water and pray that they're okay. Again, water's great, but I want you going to the hospital if you think you have this condition. Once the pain of rhabdo is over, you're better. That's a myth. Do not look at the absence of pain as an indicator that you have fully recovered from this. Remember, people with rhabdo sometimes report fatigue that'll last for several weeks or maybe even longer after they've actually gotten out of the hospital. And so we have this tendency to think, as long as it's not hurting, I'm actually okay. And then they jump right back into the gym and start exercising intensely again. And then what happens? They get rhabdo again. And so what, again, once a doctor gives you the okay to resume exercise, I recommend that you probably give yourself an extra few weeks. I think it's a great suggestion to make for anybody. Give yourself a few weeks after the doctor says it's okay. And then when you do start back again, start back nice and easy. Don't go back with the same intensity you had before. Again, for some people, again, Mr. Conservative is talking to you here. And I'm going to say, you know, even in some cases, start out with only 10, 15, maybe 20 minutes of exercise and see how you respond. And then there is another myth out there that people sometimes think that only beginners get rhabdo, and that's actually not true. Rhabdo doesn't take any prisoners. It can affect beginners. It can affect pro athletes, semi-pro athletes, etc. And so if you do work out intensely, you know, an hour and a half, 2 hours a day, that doesn't necessarily protect you from this condition. Remember, intense exercise, as I like to say, is not a vaccine against getting rhabdo. And so this condition becomes more prevalent when you do things you're not used to doing. So even though you're exercising intensely, if you jump into a new exercise program and do that intensely, it's a possibility you could get it too. So I've already let the cat out of the bag here, and so I'll say it again, but I think the odds of dying from rhabdo are actually low, but death is serious. And so I want you to take this condition serious. If you do think you have rhabdomyolysis, I think it's in your best interest to go to the hospital and please get checked out by a doctor. Don't sit there and hope for the best and bite the bullet and drink water and listen to any expert or so-called expert on the internet, and that includes me as well. The best thing you can do is go to the hospital and get checked out. So, guys, that's all I got for you today. If you have any questions, leave a question or comment below. I'll leave also some resources in the comment section where you can learn more. But that's all I got for you. I'm Joe Cannon, and I hope you have a wonderful day and this helped you. Take care. Bye-bye.